7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Disclaimer, I do not own the rights to the images or information provided. This was strictly made for the purpose of studying for boards. The general somatic efferent, GSE, lower motor neurons, LMN, in cranial nerves innervate the voluntary striated skeletal muscle derived from occipital somites, that is, tongue, cranial nerve 12, and from the head somatomeres that migrate into the branchial arches, that is, extraocular muscles, cranial nerves 3, 4, and 6, muscles of mastication, cranial nerve 5, facial muscles, cranial nerve 7, larynx, cranial nerve 10 and 11, and pharynx and esophagus, cranial nerves 9 and 10. Like spinal nerves, these cranial nerves contain neurons relating to other functional systems. Cranial nerves 3, 7, 9, and 10 contain general visceral efferent, GVE, preganglionic neurons, and most contain some form of sensory neurons. The cell bodies of these GSE neurons are found in nuclei in the brainstem from the mesencephalon through the caudal medulla, figure 6-1. Cranial nerve 3, oculomotor neurons anatomy. The GSE neuronal cell bodies of the oculomotor nerve are located in the motor nucleus of the oculomotor nerve in the rostral mesencephalon at the level of the rostral colliculi, figure 6-2, see also 6.1 and plate 7 and 8 in chapter 2. The nucleus is adjacent to the midline within the ventral portion of the central gray substance that surrounds the mesencephalic aqueduct. This nucleus is rostral to the motor nucleus of the trochlear nerve and caudal to the parasympathetic nucleus of the oculomotor nerve. The latter is caudal to the pterygeal nucleus and contains the GVE parasympathetic preganglionic neurons that are described in chapter 7. The motor nucleus of the oculomotor nerve is dorsal and medial to the red nucleus. The medial longitudinal fasciculus is located just medial and ventral to this motor nucleus. One function of this fasciculus is to interconnect the oculomotor, trochlear, and abducens GSE neurons that innervate the extraocular muscles to permit coordinated conjugate movements of the eyes. The axons of the GSE oculomotor neuronal cell bodies pass ventrally through the reticular formation of the mesencephalic tegmentum medial to the red nucleus, the substantia nigra, and the cross cerebri. They emerge on the lateral side of the interpeduncular fossa to form part of the oculomotor nerve on the medial side of the cross cerebri. This nerve courses rostrally in the middle cranial fossa beside the pituitary gland, adjacent to but not in the cavernous sinus. The oculomotor nerve leaves the cranial cavity through the orbital fissure and within the periorbita. The oculomotor nerve branches to supply the medial, dorsal, and ventral recti muscles, the ventral oblique muscle, and the levator palpebrae superioris muscle. The clinical signs caused by lesions in these GSE oculomotor neurons are described after the description of the anatomy of all three cranial nerves that innervate the extraocular muscles. Cranial nerve 4, trochlear neurons anatomy. The GSE neuronal cell bodies are located in a very small nucleus in the caudal mesencephalon at the level of the caudal colliculi, see plate 9 in chapter 2, and figure 6-1 and 6-2. This motor nucleus of the trochlear nerve is adjacent to the midline in the ventral portion of the central gray substance that surrounds the mesencephalic aqueduct. It is caudal to the larger motor nucleus of the oculomotor nerve. The medial longitudinal fasciculus, which connects the vestibular nuclei with these nuclei that innervate the extraocular muscles, lies just medial and ventral to the motor nucleus of the trochlear nerve. The axons of the GSE neuronal cell bodies in the motor nucleus of the trochlear nerve course progressively in a lateral, dorsal, caudal direction to enter the rostral medullary velum, where they continue across this velum to the opposite side and emerge just caudal to the caudal colliculus. These axons continue rostrally and ventrally on the side of the mesencephalon to reach the floor of the middle cranial fossa. They continue rostrally beside the pituitary gland adjacent to but not in the cavernous sinus and leave the cranial cavity through the orbital fissure. In some horses, this nerve leaves the cranial cavity through the trochlear foramen, which is a few millimeters dorsolateral to the orbital fissure. Within the periorbita, the trochlear neurons innervate the dorsal oblique muscle. This is the only cranial nerve with GSE neurons that innervates a muscle solely on the side opposite from its nucleus. See the discussion of the clinical signs caused by lesions that affect these trochlear neurons. Following the description of the anatomy of the abducens neurons, cranial nerve 6, abducens neurons anatomy. The GSE neurons of the abducens nerve are located in the motor nucleus of the abducens nerve in the rostral medulla. See plate 11 in chapter 2. This is a small nucleus at the level of the medulla where the caudal cerebellar peduncle merges with the cerebellum. It is adjacent to the midline and floor of the fourth ventricle. The GSE axons of the genu of the facial nerve pass over this nucleus, figure 6-3, see also figure 6-1 and 6-26. The axons of the abducens neuronal cell bodies in this motor nucleus pass directly ventral through the reticular formation of the medulla medial to the distinct dorsal nucleus of the trapezoid body. They pass through the trapezoid body and emerge just lateral to the pyramid. The abducens nerve courses rostrally on the floor of the middle cranial fossa beside the pituitary gland, adjacent to but not in the cavernous sinus, and leaves the cranial cavity through the orbital fissure. It branches within the periorbita to innervate the lateral rectus and retractor bulbi muscles. Function of cranial nerves 3, 4, and 6 function to understand the clinical signs resulting from lesions that interfere with the function of one or more of these three cranial nerves that innervate the extraocular muscles. The normal action of these muscles on the eyeball must be understood. If the eyeball is assumed to have three axes for rotation, the muscles may be grouped into three opposing pairs. If a horizontal axis through the center of the eyeball is assumed, the dorsal rectus will elevate the eyeball, and the ventral rectus will depress the eyeball. If a vertical axis through the center of the eyeball is assumed, the medial rectus will adduct the eyeball and the lateral rectus will abduct it. If an anterior to posterior axis through the center of the eyeball is assumed, the dorsal oblique will intort the eyeball, or rotate the dorsal portion medioventrally toward the nose, and the ventral oblique will extort the eyeball or rotate the dorsal portion lateroventrally away from the nose. These muscles do not function alone but continuously act together in a synergistic or antagonistic manner to provide for conjugate movements of both eyeballs in the same direction at the same time. This is easiest to appreciate by considering the action of the medial and lateral recti muscles in horizontal conjugate movements. To test the action of these muscles as part of the cranial nerve examination, the patient obviously cannot be depended on to respond to the command to look in different directions. However, the function of the oculomotor nerve to the medial rectus and the abducens nerve to the lateral rectus is readily assessed by testing for normal or physiologic nystagmus, a vestibulo-ocular test. Nystagmus is defined as involuntary movements of the eyes, and normal and abnormal forms of nystagmus exist. Testing for normal physiologic nystagmus is a part of the neurologic examination. Normal physiologic nystagmus is a jerk nystagmus, that is, a fast phase and a slow phase of the eye movement are present. The direction of the fast phase defines the direction of the nystagmus. The clinician stands over the small animal patient so that both are facing in the same direction. With large animals, the clinician stands facing the animal and is able to observe both eyes. The animal's head is moved at a moderate rate from one side to the other and repeated while watching the movements of the eyes. In small animals, it may help to elevate the superior eyelid while performing this test so that the limbus can be observed. Moving the head stimulates the sensory receptors in the inner ear that are innervated by the vestibular portion of cranial nerve 8. Impulses are relayed into the vestibular nuclei in the medulla and then pass rostrally via the medial longitudinal fasciculus to the abducens, trochlear, and oculomotor nuclei. As the animal's head is moved to the right, both eyes will exhibit a rapid movement, a jerk, toward the right. This is a normal right nystagmus. As the head is moved back to the left, both eyes will jerk to the left, which is a normal left nystagmus. In neuroanatomic terms, when the head is moved to the right eye will jerk to the right via contraction of the lateral rectus innervated by the abducens nerve, and at the same time, the left eye will jerk to the right via the contraction of the medial rectus innervated by the oculomotor nerve. When the head is swung back to the left, the opposite innervations and muscles will be activated. This action tests the function of cranial nerves 3 and 6 as well as the vestibular nerve 8, and the pathway of the medial longitudinal fasciculus through the brainstem. These are conjugate eye movements related to the movement of the head and have nothing to do with vision. This test may be performed in blind animals, as the visual pathway is not needed for this response to operate. This test is highly reliable in most dogs, horses, and farm animals, but it may be difficult to elicit a response in some cats. Often, the nystagmus, the eyeball jerk, in cats will not occur until the very end of the head movement, and the clinician must look carefully to recognize it. Occasionally, it will not be possible to elicit this eye movement in a normal cat. Serious brainstem lesions that interrupt this pathway will prevent any movement of the eyes when this normal physiologic nystagmus is tested. This is discussed further with the vestibular system in Chapter 12. Clinical signs: neuromuscular strabismus is an abnormal position of the eyeball caused by loss of innervation of extraocular muscles or by a primary extraocular muscle disorder. In dogs with developmental obstructive hydrocephalus, it may result from a malformation of the orbit rather than from denervation. The direction of the strabismus is determined by the muscles that have been denervated. Neuromuscular strabismus is present regardless of the position of the head. Lesions of the abducens neurons cause paralysis of the lateral rectus and retractor bulbi muscles. Loss of the lateral rectus innervation results in a medial strabismus. Figure 6-4. Because of the unopposed contraction of the medial rectus muscle, when testing for normal nystagmus by moving the head from one side to the other in a horizontal plane, the affected eye will not abduct when the head is moved toward the eye. The degree of abduction of the two eyes must be carefully compared to appreciate this clinical sign. No test for eyeball retraction by the retractor bulbi muscle is reliable because all the rectus muscles also have this retractor function. Lesions of the trochlear neurons cause paralysis of the dorsal oblique muscle, and a strabismus caused by the unopposed contraction of the ventral oblique muscle will be apparent. This strabismus will be contralateral to a nuclear lesion in the mesencephalon and ipsilateral to a trochlear nerve lesion after it emerges from the rostral medullary velum. In cats, which have vertical pupils, the dorsal, 12 o'clock, position of the pupil will be extorted, deviated laterally. Figure 6-5 shows a 4-year-old domestic short hair with an anatomic diagnosis of the left mesencephalon, pons, and medulla, including cranial nerves 4, 5, 7, and 8. The strabismus is caused by the deficiency of the left trochlear nerve. Magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, of this cat showed hyperintensity in the left tympanic cavity and contrast enhancement in the adjacent meninges in left side of the brainstem and cerebellum. Figure 6-6. The presumptive diagnosis was a suppurative otitis media interna with extension into the adjacent meninges, brainstem, and cerebellum. In horses and ruminants, which have horizontal pupils, the medial aspect of the pupil will be extorted dorsally. This is often referred to as dorsomedial strabismus. In ruminants, this is a clinical sign that commonly occurs in severe cases of a metabolic disorder caused by thiamine deficiency and is referred to, according to lesion that occurs, as paleoencephalomalacia. This is thought to represent dysfunction of the motor nucleus of the trochlear nerve. In dogs, with their round pupils, extorsion cannot be appreciated unless a fundic examination is performed in the position of the superior retinal vein, which normally courses in a superior direction from the optic disc, is looked for. It will be deviated laterally in a trochlear nerve paralysis. Trochlear nerve strabismus is rarely observed except in the ruminant disorder just described. Lesions of the GSE oculomotor neurons cause paralysis of the dorsal and ventral rectus, the ventral oblique, and the medial rectus muscles, as well as the levator palpebrae superioris. Loss of the function of the levator muscle causes a smaller palpebral fissure because of ptosis resulting from the inability to elevate the superior eyelid. Paralysis of the extraocular muscles causes a ventral lateral strabismus. See figure 6-4. The lateral deviation is explained by the unopposed contraction of the lateral rectus muscle. The mild ventral deviation is caused by the unopposed contraction of the dorsal oblique muscle. The tendon of the dorsal oblique muscle inserts on the eye just caudal to the equator, which, therefore, rotates the eye ventrally when it is unopposed by the ventral oblique muscle. The loss of the ability to adduct the eye may be readily observed when the patient is tested for normal nystagmus by moving the head in a horizontal plane. The affected eye will not adduct fully when the head is moved in the direction of the normal eye. In small animals, when the head and neck are extended, the eyes normally move dorsally to stay in the center of the palpebral fissure. Paralysis of the dorsal rectus muscle prevents this in the affected eye, and the dorsal aspect of the sclera is observed when this movement is performed. In the horse and ruminants, especially cattle, the eyes normally do not move dorsally as the head and neck are extended, and normally, the dorsal aspect of the sclera in both eyes is observed. Lesions that involve all components of the oculomotor nerve also cause dilated pupils that are unresponsive to light because of the loss of the GVE parasympathetic preganglionic neurons that innervate the iris constrictor muscle. This is described in Chapter 7 where the GVE system is discussed. The GVE axons are more at risk from compression by extraparenchymal neoplasms or intraparenchymal lesions that cause brain enlargement. Therefore, with compression of the oculomotor nerve, the GVE signs are recognized first. A vestibular strabismus is a ventral lateral strabismus that is observed in some positions of the head when the vestibular system is affected by a lesion. The strabismus is ipsilateral to the vestibular system lesion. It may be differentiated from an oculomotor nerve strabismus because it is not present in all positions of the head, and when testing for normal, physiologic, nystagmus, the affected eye will adduct as well as the opposite eye. A GSE neuronal strabismus will be present in all positions of the head. Strabismus may also occur with some congenital anomalies in the architecture of the central projections of the visual system. A mild bilateral medial strabismus is observed in Siamese cats. This breed has a higher portion of retinal ganglion cell neurons whose axons cross at the optic chiasm and project to the contralateral lateral geniculate nucleus. Disease is the most common lesion to involve one or more of these cranial nerves that innervate the extraocular muscles is a neoplasm that is retrobulbar or extraparenchymal, extraaxial, in the middle cranial fossa. Meningiomycin germ cell neoplasms are the most common neoplasms in the middle cranial fossa to affect these cranial nerves. In the literature, the clinical signs of neoplasms located here that affect cranial nerves 3, 4, and 6 in the ophthalmic and maxillary nerves from cranial nerve 5 have been referred to as cavernous sinus syndrome. This term should be discarded because these nerves have nothing to do with the cavernous sinus other than to course by it to leave the cranial cavity. Pituitary microadenomas rarely affect these nerves. Cranial nerve 5, trigeminal neurons anatomy. The GSE neuronal cell bodies are located in the motor nucleus of the trigeminal nerve, which is a small, well-defined nucleus in the pons. See Play 10 in Chapter 2. This nucleus is found at the level of middle and rostral cerebellar peduncles, just rostral to where all three cerebellar peduncles merge with the cerebellum. It is medial to the pontine sensory nucleus of the trigeminal nerve and dorsal to the dorsal nucleus of the trapezoid body. Figure 6-7. See also Figure 6-1. The axons pass ventrolaterally through the middle cerebellar peduncle to join the sensory neurons of the trigeminal nerve that are entering the pons. As these motor neurons emerge from the pons, they may be seen as a small separate motor nerve on the medial aspect of the sensory portion of the trigeminal nerve before the nerve disappears into the canal for the trigeminal nerve in the petrosal portion of the temporal bone. Within this canal, these motor neurons pass through the large trigeminal ganglion to join the mandibular nerve that passes through the oval foramen, where the motor neurons are distributed to the muscles of mastication, merceter, temporal, pterygoid, rostral digastricus, and mylohyoideus. Clinical signs: unilateral loss of function of the trigeminal motor neurons will be recognized only when atrophy occurs in the muscles of mastication. Figure 6-8 and 6-9. This will be observed more readily in the short-haired breeds. In the neurologic examination, these muscles must be palpated or this improton clinical sign will be missed, especially in long-haired breeds such as the Old English Sheepdog. Atrophy of the individual muscles of mastication is easily identified with MRI. In the horse, a slight deviation of the lower jaw may be present toward the normal side, but this may be difficult to recognize. Bilateral loss of function in these trigeminal motor neurons must have occurred to result in failure to prehend food because the mouth cannot be closed. An open mouth caused by a dropped mandible that the patient cannot close but that can manually be closed requires the anatomic diagnosis of bilateral motor cranial nerve 5. Disease is nerve sheath neoplasm. The most common lesion that causes a unilateral loss of the GSE, LMN in the trigeminal nerve is a malignant nerve sheath neoplasm. This is a neoplasm of Schwann cells that occurs in older dogs. The first indication of the neoplasm is usually recognition of atrophy in the muscles of mastication. See Figure 6-8 and 6-9. No recognizable loss of temporomandibular joint function is present. The clinician must be aware that the loss of general somatic afferent XA, neurons in the ophthalmic nerve, which is a branch of the trigeminal nerve, may cause a neurotrophic keratitis and may be the first clinical sign observed. Often, no detectable loss of sensory function occurs with this neoplasm, but it commonly expands into the cranial cavity and slowly compresses the brainstem, with its mass centered at the pons. Figure 6-10 and 6-11. This will lead to other cranial nerve signs. Facial and vestibulocochlear, on the same side, and abnormal postural reactions and gait in the ipsilateral limbs. CT and MRI will help diagnose this mass lesion and determine the extent of its growth. Figure 6-12 through 6-16. Additionally, both MRI and CT will help identify atrophy in each of the muscles of mastication, further supporting the origin of the mass and the correct diagnosis. Further confirmation of the diagnosis of a nerve sheath neoplasm of cranial nerve may fifth be obtained from a dorsoventral radio graph of the cranium and recognizing an enlargement of the oval foramen on the affected side just rostral to the apex of the petrosal portion of the temporal bone. This often occurs with a slowly growing neoplasm from its involvement of the mandibular nerve, which is a branch of cranial nerve 5. It is important to be aware that a percentage of dogs with malignant nerve sheath tumors of the trigeminal nerve or other disease processes affecting the mandibular branch of the trigeminal nerve may also have middle ear effusion caused by denervation of the tensor valley palatini muscle, which is responsible for regulation of the normal tone of the auditory tube. This is also seen in cats with diseases affecting the mandibular branch of the trigeminal nerve. Surgical removal is difficult because of the location of the mass, but it has been described. Usually, this neoplasm is treated with radiation, and corticosteroids are used to control paralesional edema. The trigeminal nerve is the most common cranial nerve to develop this nerve sheath neoplasm in animals. Lymphoma may also develop within this cranial nerve, especially in cats. Video 6-1 shows Smokey, a 10-year-old spayed female domestic short-haired cat, which had been unable to close her mouth for 10 days, during which time she was hand-fed food and water by the owner. In addition to the dropped mandible that she could not move, bilateral facial analgesia had been caused by the loss of function of the XA neurons in all three branches of the trigeminal nerves. Note the spontaneous blinking of the eyelids but no palpable reflex because of the loss of the trigeminal sensory neurons. Also, note the normal menace response in the ear movement, which supports normal functioning of the facial neurons. Nociception in the ear is normal because it has numerous sources of sensory innervation in addition to the small area supplied by the trigeminal nerve. Figure 6-17 through 6-19 show the brain of this cat and the bilaterally enlarged trigeminal nerves caused by an infiltrating lymphoma. Trigeminal neuritis in dogs. The most common cause of sudden inability to close the mouth is a bilateral non-suppurative trigeminal neuritis. This is also referred to as trigeminal neuropathy, but it is an inflammatory disease that is thought to be an autoimmune disorder. A direct viral infection cannot be excluded, nor can an indirect infection that provides an antigen in common with cranial nerves. In my AD autopsy study of one affected dog, this inflammatory lesion was in all components of the trigeminal nerve bilaterally, including the ganglia. Demyelination was prominent, and axonal degeneration was rare, indicating that this was predominantly a primary demyelination. Numerous lymphoplasmacytic perivascular cuffs and many macrophages engulfing the degenerate myelin were seen. This lesion is similar to that found in the ventral roots of dogs with polyradicular neuritis. When examining dogs with trigeminal neuritis, the mandible is found to have dropped, just hanging loose. The mouth can be manually closed by elevating the mandible, but when released, the mandible drops back to its initial position. Usually, these dogs have normal use of their tongues and can swallow when food or water is placed in the caudal portion of the oral cavity and oral pharynx. Observing movement of the tongue without concurrent movement of the mandible is a clear hint of severe paresis of the muscles of mastication. This is especially useful in dogs with substantial facial hair. Occasionally, swallowing may be difficult for a few days. Saliva accumulates around the lips and nose. Figure 6-20. About 1/3 of these dogs also have loss of facial sense of shine because of the involvement of XA neurons that are abundant in all three major branches of this nerve. A few dogs exhibit sympathetic paralysis of the head, which is referred to as Horner syndrome. This is presumed to be caused by the involvement of the postganglionic sympathetic axons that join the ophthalmic nerve near its origin from the trigeminal nerve to reach the smooth muscle of the eye, eyelids, and periorbita. Figure 6-21. Rarely, mild facial neuritis and paresis are present. Most of these dogs spontaneously recover in about 3 weeks, with or without significant atrophy of the masticatory muscles. The degree of atrophy reflects the degree of axonal involvement. Unilateral cases may be overlooked because they will be recognized only by this atrophy. MRI shows diffuse enlargement of the affected nerves, with hyperintensity on T2 weighted images and contrast enhancement of T1 weighted donated images. Billet or lie affected dogs must be hand-fed with food and water for the first 7 to 10 days. We do not treat these dogs with immunosuppressive drugs such as corticosteroids because no evidence suggests that these drugs have any influence on the rate of recovery. That probably reflects the degree of axonal injury. Recovery is short if the axons have been spared and only remyelination is necessary. Recurrences of this disorder are uncommon. We have made this clinical diagnosis in cats, but it is much less common in that species. Figure 6-22. Despite reports in the literature, the mandibular branches of the trigeminal nerve that innervate these muscles cannot be injured by opening the mouth too wide. The following two videos are examples of this disorder. Video 6-2 shows a 5-year-old spayed female English Springer Spaniel, just 2 days after a sudden onset of inability to close the mouth to prehend food. Note that there is no loss of facial sensation. Video 6-3 shows a 4-year-old spayed female Schnauzer, Haley, 1 day after a sudden onset of inability to close its mouth to prehend food. Note the marked bilateral facial hypalgesia. No palpebral reflex exists, but note the spontaneous blinking of the eyelids, which indicates normal facial nerve function. Stimulating the skin of the external ear canal tests multiple cranial and cervical spinal nerves and is not reliable for cranial nerve 5. The ear movement supports normal facial nerve function. See Chapter 12 for the description of polycranial neuritis that may involve this trigeminal neuritis. Encephalitis that involves the motor nuclei of the trigeminal nerve bilaterally causes paresis or paralysis of the muscles of mastication that results in an open mouth that cannot be closed to prehend food. Infections by Listeria monocytogenes in ruminants and by Sarcocystis neurona in horses are examples of this. Figure 6-23 through 6-25. Myositis of the muscles of mastication is described in Chapter 5. It is not a cause of an inability to close the mouth and has no relationship to any dysfunction of the trigeminal nerve. In the acute stage, when the muscles are swollen, any attempt to open the mouth causes extreme discomfort. In the chronic stage, when the muscles are severely atrophied, the fibrosis that has developed in the muscles may mechanically prevent the mouth from being opened. This myositis is treated by long-term corticosteroids and more recently by oral cyclosporin. Cranial nerve 7, facial neurons anatomy. The cell bodies of the GSE neurons in the facial nerve are located in the facial nucleus in the rostral medulla. This well-defined nucleus is ventrolateral in the medulla, midway between the pyramid medially and the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve laterally, caudal. Cranial nerve 7, facial neurons anatomy. The cell bodies of the GSE neurons in the facial nerve are located in the facial nucleus in the rostral medulla. This well-defined nucleus is ventrolateral in the medulla, midway between the pyramid medially and the spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve laterally, caudal to the trapezoid body and the level of attachment of the caudal cerebellar pedon. Cleta the cerebellum, see Plate 12 in Chapter 2. It is caudal to the dorsal nucleus of the trapezoid body and rostral to the olivary nucleus. See Figure 6-26 later in this chapter. See also Figure 6-1 and 6-3. The axons of the cell bodies initially pass dorsomedially to the midline of the floor of the fourth ventricle. Here, they course rostrally for 1 to 2 millimeters, mm, dorsal to the abducens nucleus and the genu of the facial facial nerve. Then they course ventrolaterally through the medulla, medial to the spinal nucleus and tract of the trigeminal nerve and lateral to the dorsal nucleus of the trapezoid body. They emerge through the lateral aspect of the trapezoid body, ventral to the vestibulocochlear nerve. See plate 11 in chapter 2. The facial nerve accompanies the vestibulocochlear nerve into the internal acoustic meatus of the petrosal portion of the temporal bone. The facial nerve is more dorsal. It enters the facial canal within the temporal bone and emerges through the stylomastoid foramen. Branches of the facial nerve are distributed to the muscles of facial expression. These are the relatively thin muscles of ear, eyelids, nose, cheeks, and lips. The facial nerve also innervates the caudal portion of the digastricus muscle, which belongs to the muscles of mastication. Clinical signs: lesions of the facial nucleus or the facial nerve from the medulla to where it emerges from the stylomastoid foramen result in complete facial paresis or in paralysis and inability to move these facial muscles normally. Paralysis may be recognized by asymmetry of the face, but that depends on the species. The most obvious asymmetry occurs in the horse. Figure 6-27, on the paralyzed side, the ear droops, the palpebral fissure is decreased in size, the superior lip droops, and the nose and superior lip are markedly deviated toward the normal side because of the unopposed contractions of the muscles of the lip and nose on that side. Even the angle of the superior eyelid lashes is decreased on the affected side when the two sides are carefully compared. The ear droop, small palpebral fissure, deviated nose, and lip droop are usually seen in small ruminants, except for the ear in breeds with pendular ears, for example, the Nubian goat. The same clinical signs are seen in cattle, but no deviation of the plenum nasolabial is present. Figure 6-28 and 6-29. In small animals, deviation of the nose and, usually, decrease in size of the palpebral fissure do not occur. Figure 6-30. The latter suggests that the levator anguli oculi medialis plays a significant role in eyelid elevation in horses and farm animals. Occasionally, this fissure is slightly enlarged on the affected side in small animals. It is important to be aware that the sympathetic and facial nerves may be affected by middle ear disorders, and a smaller palpebral fissure may be caused by loss of the sympathetic innervation to the eye. However, this is accompanied by pupillary meiosis and an elevated third eyelid, with facial paresis or paralysis. No ear droop occurs in cats and in many dogs with erect ears because ear cartilage is taut enough to keep the ear erect despite the paralysis of the ear muscles. See figure 6-30 and 6-37 later in the chapter. If the head of a small animal is elevated and the corners of the lips examined, the likely finding is that more mucosa is exposed on the paralyzed side, and more saliva may be lost on this side. Loss of tone in the lips is more difficult to feel in small animals than in the horse and in farm animals. No spontaneous eyelid blinking is seen on the affected side, and no movement of the nares may be observed on that side during inspiration. The most reliable test for facial nerve function is the palpebral reflex, which may be elicited by touching the corners of the eyelids or blowing into the eye. See figure 6-36 later in the chapter. The sensory neurons stimulated her in the branches of the trigeminal nerve. They enter the pons with the trigeminal nerve and course through the medulla and the spinal tract of the trigeminal nerve. Synapse occurs on neuronal cell bodies in the adjacent spinal nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. They, in turn, synapse on the GSE neurons in the facial nucleus in the rostral medulla to complete the reflex arc. This results in a brisk closure of the eyelids. We usually avoid doing the corneal reflex, which is stimulated by touching the cornea, so as not to injure the cornea, which, in animals, is much less sensitive than in humans. In patients with facial paresis, it may be possible to determine the paresis by trying to elevate the superior eyelid with the fingers. In normal horses and cattle, this may be difficult to do. In breeds with erect ears that do not droop with facial paralysis, it may be possible to determine the inability to move the ear by blowing into the ear and mildly stimulating the skin of the external ear canal with a blunt instrument and comparing the ear movement responses on each side. On the affected side, the ear will not move, but the patient may move its head away or might bite or scratch. When lesions affect the individual branches of the facial nerve, along their course to the muscles they innervate, the lesions produce paresis or paralysis that is restricted to those muscle groups. In horses, the buccal branches of the facial nerve are close together where they course laterally across the caudal border of the ramus of the mandible to reach the surface of the masseter muscle, where they separate and continue on to innervate the muscles of the nose and lips. Where these branches cross this ramus, they are subject to compression injury when the horse is tabled for surgery, and this area is not protected by padding, especially if the halter is not removed. The clinical signs are limited to a drooped inferior lip and a deviated nose and superior lip. Eyelid and ear position and movement are normal. Figure 6-31. Cattle that struggle to pull their heads out of stanchions may injure one or both of the palpebral branches of the oculopalpebral nerve as it courses across the zygomatic arch, which is the widest portion of the skull. Usually, only eyelid paresis or paralysis results. This nerve may be blocked by a local anesthetic at the same point to permit examination of the eye in animals that will not allow opening of the eyelids, especially horses. Occasionally, cattle that struggle vigorously may also injure the auricular branches of the oculopalpebral nerves and cause ipsilateral ear droop and loss of ear motion. This injury is referred to as stanchion paralysis. It is important to be aware that the facial and vestibulocochlear nerves are very closely associated from the medulla into the petrosal portion of the temporal bone. As a result, the same lesion often causes dysfunction of both of these cranial nerves. A neoplasm compressing the medulla or otitis media in turn may cause dysfunction in these two cranial nerves. It is important to recognize clinical signs of involvement of other functional systems when the medulla is the site of a lesion because they will greatly influence the differential diagnosis, selection of ancillary procedures, therapy, and prognosis. These other functional systems in the medulla include the upper motor neuron, causing a hemiparesis or tetraparesis, general proprioception, GP, producing ataxia, the ascending reticular activating system, causing depression or lethargy, and the nuclei of other cranial nerves. It must be kept in mind that any animal with complete facial paralysis may have a lesion anywhere between the level of the facial nucleus in the medulla and the level of the stylomastoid foramen. In addition, lesions of the facial nerve at this level that involve the parasympathetic GVE axons in the major petrosal nerve may cause keratoconjunctivitis sicca and possibly a crusty nasal plenum from the absence of tears and nasal gland secretions. The recognition of the presence or absence of other clinical signs is critical to making the correct anatomic diagnosis. See figure 6-28 and 6-29. Diseases otitis media. By far the most common definitive cause of facial paralysis in all species is otitis media. Inflammation in the middle ear that involves the facial nerve as it courses through the facial canal in the petrosal portion of the temporal bone. A portion of this canal that is adjacent to the tympanic, middle ear, cavity lacks a bony wall, and the nerve is separated from the cavity by only a few microvilli loose connective tissue. Figure 6-32. A lesion at this level causes facial paresis or paralysis. Figure 6-33 and 6-34. It may be accompanied by peripheral vestibular system dysfunction because of involvement of the receptors in the inner ear. Unilateral deafness caused by loss of the receptors receptors for hearing on one side cannot be determined by physical neurologic examination or even by the owner. This diagnosis requires a brainstem auditory evoked response test, which is an electrophysiologic evaluation. In small animals, middle ear inflammation may involve the GVE postganglionic sympathetic axons in their course from the cranial cervical ganglion to the ophthalmic nerve where it arises from the trigeminal nerve. These GVE axons innervate the smooth muscle of the eyelid, periorbita, and iris dilator muscle. See Chapter 7 for a discussion of this pathway. The loss of function of these sympathetic neurons causes Horner syndrome. Figure 6-35 through 6-37 show young domes tick short hair with facial paralysis, peripheral vestibular signs, and Horner syndrome caused by unilateral otitis media interna. The diagnosis of otitis media can often be supported by head radiography or advanced imaging, MRI, CT. CT may provide the best detail for both the osseous and soft tissue changes that occur in this disorder. Figure 6-38 and 6-39. Otitis media interna should be treated aggressively to prevent extension of the infection from the inner ear into the cranial cavity. Caudal brainstem and cerebellar abscesses commonly occur secondary to otitis in young farm animals, especially calves, lambs, and pigs. Figure 6-40. It occasionally occurs in cats, in which otitis media is very common and often subclinical. A significant percentage of cats that are autopsied for other reasons are also found to have incidental otitis media. The clinician must be aware that long-term therapy with corticosteroids for undiagnosed facial or vestibular nerve dysfunction in an animal that has otitis media may lead to petrosal bone osteomyelitis and brainstem compression or infection. These patients may sometimes be appropriately treated medically, surgically, or both, with successful outcomes despite extension of the lesion into the cranial cavity. Video 6-4 shows two Holstein calves with otitis media interna. The smaller calf is 2 months old and exhibits a right-side facial paralysis and clinical signs of a right-side peripheral vestibular system dysfunction. Diagnosis was made with radiography. The larger calf is 4 months old and has left facial paralysis caused by otitis media but also shows involvement of the medulla causing the following: depression, need of assistance to stand, and an extended neck. The latter clinical signs were caused by the abscess that had formed in the medulla and pons caused by the ear infection invading the cranial cavity. Video 6-5 shows a 1-month-old Holstein calf with bilateral droop resulting from facial paralysis secondary to bilateral otitis media. The video includes the CT images that supported this diagnosis. In horses, otitis media has been associated with a proliferative bone lesion involving the articulations of the stylohyoid, tympanohyoid, and the temporal bones. The cause of these bone lesions is unknown. Both inflammatory and mechanical hypotheses have been proposed. The bony proliferation causes ankylosis of these articulations, fusing the stylohyoid bone to the temporal bone. This prevents any movement of the hyoid apparatus associated with swallowing and vocalization and may lead to fracture of the temporal bone. Facial paralysis, with or without clinical signs of dysfunction of the peripheral vestibular system, may precede the fracture caused by the otitis or follow the fracture caused by injury of the facial nerve. If the possibility of this joint fusion is suspected, the mobility of the hyoid apparatus should be palpated by placing the fingers on the basohyoid bone or its lingual process and lifting up on it. The clinician should practice on normal horses to learn how much mobility exists in the normal hyoid apparatus when it is manipulated this way. When this temporohyoid joint is fused, considerable resistance will be felt when lifting up on the basohyoid bone. In most cases, this stylohyoid osteopathy may be confirmed by endoscopic examination of the guttural pouch. Video 6-6 shows guttural pouch endoscopy of an 8-year-old horse with a sudden onset of left facial paralysis. The left compartment of the guttural pouch is shown first. Note the enlargement of the stylohyoid bone at the tympanohyoid articulation and the lack of any motion here caused by the fusion that has occurred. Compare this with a view of the right compartment that follows and shows the normal stylohyoid bone and the movement at this joint. Head radiographs may reveal this bone lesion, but CT imaging is the most reliable procedure for confirming this diagnosis. Figure 6-41 through 6-43. The otitis is treated with antibiotics. Surgical removal of the carotid bone prevents further trauma to the temporal bone. If the diagnosis of this stylohyoid osteopathy is made before any neurologic signs are present, this surgery may be done as a prophylactic measure. Videos 12-22 through 12-24 in Chapter 12, where the vestibular system is discussed, show horses with this disorder, facial nerve tetanus, hemiphagia. Facial nerve tetanus, hemifacial spasm. Facial nerve tetanus is a unique disorder of the facial nerve in dogs that has been related to otitis media, but this correlation is poorly documented and inconsistent. The clinical signs show continual contraction of the muscles innervated by the facial nerve on one side. The facial nerve function on the opposite side is usually normal. These dogs present with a slight elevation of the ear, a narrowed palpebral fissure, taut lips with the angle drawn caudally, and a nose slightly deviated toward the affected side. Figure 6-44 and 6-45. Some of these dogs exhibit slight movement of the eyelids, lips, and ear when those areas are stimulated. This syndrome has been called hemifacial spasm, but that is a misnomer because it is not a spasm of the muscles in the true sense. The neuromuscular activity is constant. Some clinicians have described it to be the result of complete facial paralysis with innervation atrophy that causes shortening, contracture, of the facial muscles. We disagree with this hypothesis for the following reason. If general anesthesia is administered to one of these dogs or if the affected buccal branches are blocked by a local anesthetic, the clinical signs immediately disappear. They return when the anesthetic has resolved. This supports the idea that a neurogenic stimulus is the basis for these clinical signs rather than an innervation atrophy or other myopathic disorder. A more accurate name for this disorder is facial tetanus. As a clinical sign, tetanus is defined as the sustained contraction of muscles without relaxation. It is caused by high-frequency repetitive stimulation of the motor neurons innervating the muscles involved. Some of these dogs have otitis media on the affected side, with or without any signs of dysfunction in the vestibular system or in the sympathetic innervation of the head. However, a significant number have no clinical signs of otitis media, and MRI and CT are normal. I recently performed extensive MRI on an affected dog in which the combined facial and vestibulocochlear nerves were visible on both sides of the middle and no lesions were recognized. No evidence of otitis media was observed. These tetanic signs may be the first indication of a disorder of the facial nerve or may follow a facial paralysis. The tetanic signs do not respond well to antibiotic therapy for otitis media when it is present. It appears that facial tetanus is permanent in most patients. The neurophysiologic mechanism of facial tetanus is unknown. If it were a central functional disinhibition at the level of the facial nucleus, we would expect it to be bilateral. Until we have a better explanation, we assume facial tetanus is the result of an irritative lesion such as a neuritis affecting the LMN within the extraparenchymal facial nerve. The hemifacial spasm in humans is a true spasmodic disorder and is related to abnormal contact between the facial nerve and an aberrant blood vessel that may be a branch of the labyrinthine artery because they both enter the internal acoustic meatus. The facial nerve excitation is related to the compressive neuropathy caused by the anomalous blood vessel. Decompression often relieves the clinical signs. I have observed facial tetanus in a 9-year-old dachshund crossbreed with inflammatory brain disease. The facial tetanus resolved with immunosuppression. We have not seen facial tetanus in any other species of domestic animal. Video 6-7 shows Baron, a 5-year-old male golden retriever with a 1-month history of right otitis externa, a right head tilt 2 weeks later, and a few days of drooling from the left lips. Note the normal gait and normal postural reactions. No head tilt existed at the time of this examination. Note the signs of facial tetanus on the dog's right side and the paralysis on his left side. The absent palpebral reflex on the left could be caused by loss of sensory nerve 5 or motor nerve 7. If a dog reacts to the placing of a blunt instrument on the nasal septal mucosa, sensory 5 innervation is intact. In this dog, when a conjunctiva was touched with forceps, the eye was retracted, indicating normal sensory 5 innervation. Similarly, the absent menace response could result from loss of vision or motor 7. To determine that he can still see with the eye, watch carefully for the eye to retract, and thus for the third eyelid to elevate. When the eye is menaced, the clinician must be careful not to touch the dog or create an air current when the eye is menaced, or the sensory stimulus to cranial nerve 5 will be changed. Radiographic studies confirm bilateral otitis media in Baron. We assume that neuritis occurred in the facial nerves, causing paralysis on the left and facial tetanus on the right. Idiopathic facial neuropathy. Neuritis. Idiopathic facial paralysis occurs in older dogs. The Cocker Spaniel and Beagle are at some risk for this disorder, but we have seen it in many breeds. Occasionally, an affected dog has hypothyroidism, but its relationship to the facial nerve disorder is still speculative. Clinical laboratory studies should support hypothyroidism and severe hypercholesterolemia. An ischemic neuropathy may be the result of hypothyroid-induced atherosclerosis or increased blood viscosity. In some dogs, the facial paralysis is accompanied by clinical signs of involvement of the vestibular portion of cranial nerve 8. Response of these dogs to thyroid supplementation is usually satisfactory. Ultimately, this idiopathic disorder is a diagnosis of exclusion that is based on the inability to diagnose any causative abnormality using routine MRI or CT, evaluation of cerebrospinal fluid, CSF, and metabolic studies. A recent MRI study of the intratemporal course of the facial nerve in patients with this clinical diagnosis showed contrast enhancement in at least one segment of the facial nerve in 3 of the 5 dogs that were studied. Further studies are needed to correlate this information with morphologic change in the affected facial nerve segment. It is not known whether any neuritis is involved. Bell palsy in humans is a similar facial paralysis and is thought to be related to infection by the herpes simplex virus. One study of biopsies of the buccal branches of the facial nerves in dogs with this diagnosis showed degeneration of the neuronal processes, a neuropathy, but that could be a result of neuritis in the nerve prior to its emergence from the stylomastoid foramen. No other cranial nerves are clinically affected along with this facial nerve disorder. The prognosis should be guarded. Spontaneous recovery may occur in weeks to months or might not occur at all. No effective treatment is recognized. The clinician must be aware that corneal lesions may occur because of exposure caused by the lack of eyelid closure or the absence of tears if the parasympathetic preganglionic neurons that innervate the lacrimal gland and the gland of the third eyelid are affected in the proximal part of the facial nerve or more distal to than in their course to the pterygopalatine ganglion. Occasionally, this disorder progresses to affect both facial nerves. See Chapter 12 for the description of polycranial neuritis that may involve a facial neuritis. Cranial nerves 9, 10, and 11, glossopharyngeal, vagal, accessory neurons anatomy. Cranial nerves 9, 10, and 11 are considered together because their metallurgy's neuronal cell bodies are all located in one nucleus, the nucleus ambiguous. The accessory nerve also has a spinal cord component. These medullary cell bodies are topographically organized in the nucleus ambiguous, with the most rostral portion contributing to the glossopharyngeal nerve and the most caudal to the accessory nerve. Nucleus ambiguous is an ill-defined column of neuronal cell bodies located ventrolaterally in the medulla, medial to the spinal tract and nucleus of the trigeminal nerve. See plate 15 in chapter 2. It extends from the facial nucleus rostrally through the caudal medulla to a level slightly caudal to the obex. It is continued by the motor nucleus of the accessory nerve through the gray matter of all the cervical spinal cord segments. Figure 6-46. Glossopharyngeal nerve. The GSE neuronal cell bodies are located in the rostral portion of the nucleus ambiguous, motor nucleus of the glossopharyngeal nerve. Their axons arch slightly dorsally and then ventrolaterally to emerge along the lateral aspect of the medulla along with the GVE preganglionic neurons from cell bodies in the parasympathetic nucleus of the glossopharyngeal nerve. These two sets of axons form the motor portion of the glossopharyngeal nerve just caudal to the vestibulocochlear nerve. The glossopharyngeal nerve courses through the jugular foramen and emerges from the tympanooccipital fissure, where it contributes pharyngeal branches to innervate the stylopharyngeus muscle and other pharyngeal muscles via the pharyngoesophageal plexus, which includes a contribution from the vagus nerve. Vagus nerve. The axons of the GSE cell bodies in the middle portion of the nucleus ambiguous, motor nucleus of the vagus nerve, take a similar intramedullary course and emerge on the lateral aspect of the middle rostral to the internal branch of the accessory nerve. They are joined by the GVE preganglionic axons from the parasympathetic nucleus of the vagus to form the motor portion of the vagus nerve. The vagus nerve leaves the cranial cavity through the jugular foramen and emerges from the skull via the tympanooccipital fissure. Between the jugular foramen and the tympanooccipital fissure, the vagus nerve is joined by the internal branch of the accessory nerve. On the dorsal surface of the pharynx, the vagus nerve provides pharyngeal branches that form a plexus with pharyngeal branches of the glossopharyngeal nerve. This pharyngoesophageal plexus innervates the striated muscles of the palate, pharynx, and cervical esophagus. A cranial laryngeal branch innervates the cricothyroid muscle. The recurrent laryngeal nerve is a branch of the vagus nerve in the cranial mediastinum. It contains the GSE neurons of the internal branch of the accessory nerve that innervate all the other intrinsic muscles of the larynx via the caudal laryngeal nerve as well as the cervical and cranial thoracic esophagus. As the vagus nerve courses caudally in the thorax on the surface of the esophagus, small branches supply its striated muscle with GSE innervation. Accessory nerve. The motor nucleus of the accessory nerve in the medulla is continuous with the caudal aspect of nucleus ambiguous. The axons of these neuronal cell bodies arch slightly dorsally and course ventrolaterally to emerge from the lateral aspect of the medulla as the cranial roots of the accessory nerve. Here, they are joined by GVE neurons from the caudal portion of the parasympathetic nucleus of cranial nerve 11 to form the internal branch of the accessory nerve. The external branch of the accessory nerve is formed by the spinal roots of this nerve, the cell bodies of which are located in the lateral portion of the ventral gray horn of the 8 cervical spinal cord segments. The axons of these cell bodies pass laterally to emerge from the lateral side of the cervical spinal cord as the spinal roots of the accessory nerve. These join to form a common bundle, the external branch of the accessory nerve, which courses cranially just dorsal to the denticulate ligament and between the segmental dorsal and ventral rootlets of the cervical spinal nerves. See figure 6-46. More GSE neurons are added to this external branch at each successive cervical segment as it courses cranially. The external branch passes cranially through the foramen magnum into the caudal cranial fossa of the cranial cavity. Here, it is joined by the internal branch but for only a few millimeters. The two branches that comprise the accessory nerve pass through the jugular foramen. Within the short passageway between the jugular foramen and the tympanooccipital fissure, the internal branch of the accessory nerve joins the vagus nerve. Therefore, the accessory nerve that emerges from the tympanooccipital fissure contains only the GSE neurons from the external branch, and these neurons innervate the trapezius, sternocephalicus, and cleidocephalicus muscles. The GSE neurons in the internal branch of the accessory nerve that join the vagus nerve innervate the intrinsic muscles of the larynx and cervical and cranial thoracic esophagus by way of the recurrent laryngeal nerve. The branches from the vagus nerve in the cranial thoracic mediastinum. Clinical signs: lesions in the motor nucleus of the accessory nerve, in the GSE axons of the internal branch of the accessory nerve, in the cervical portion of the vagus nerve or its recurrent laryngeal branch, or in the caudal laryngeal nerve of the muscles of the larynx result in laryngeal paralysis. This causes an inspiratory dyspnea. When this is recognized in most small animals, bilateral paralysis is considered to exist. In racehorses, unilateral laryngeal paralysis is a common cause of poor performance. The inspiratory dyspnea may be severe enough to be audible in the exercised horse and is referred to as roaring. The inspiratory dyspnea is caused by the failure of the coracoidomoideus dorsalis muscles to completely abduct the vocal folds, which interferes with airflow on inspiration. Lesions in the nucleus ambiguous, in the GSE axons in the vagus and glossopharyngeal nerves, or in the muscles of the pharynx or esophagus result in varying degrees of difficulty in swallowing, which is referred to as dysphagia. In unilateral pharyngeal paresis, partial ability to swallow exists, but choking, gagging, and loss of food through the nares occur. With bilateral lesions, swallowing cannot be accomplished, choking and gagging are worse, and food commonly appears at the nares. With complete lesions, no gag reflex is present in small animals, but with partial lesions, this is a very difficult reflex to assess because of the marked variation in normal animals. In some dog breeds, especially the Labrador and the Golden Retriever, this reflex is very difficult to assess reliably. The most reliable indication of a problem with swallowing is the owner's description of the patient's attempts to eat and drink. We have not observed in any domestic animal reliable clinical signs of lesions involving portions of the GSE neurons in the accessory nerve that innervate the cervical muscles. Diseases or pharyngeal dysphagia as the only clinical sign is uncommon in small animals. It occasionally occurs with extracranial neoplasms that involve the pharyngoesophageal plexus. Megaesophagus regurgitation, associated with megaesophagus as the only clinical sign, occurs in two forms, congenital and acquired. A congenital idiopathic megaesophagus causes regurgitation that is first observed as the puppy is weaned from a liquid to a solid food diet. A late-onset acquired form of megaesophagus occurs in older dogs and in many dogs is thought to be a form of focal myasthenia gravis. This is described with the spinal nerve LMN diseases in Chapter 5. Congenital idiopathic megaesophagus has been reported in most breeds of dogs, but a high incidence is seen in the German Shepherd dog, Great Dane, Irish Setter, Labrador Retriever, Chinese Shar-Pei, and Newfoundland breeds. An inherited pathogenesis has been reported in the Wire Fox Terrier and Miniature Schnauzer breeds. The most salient clinical sign is postprandial regurgitation. A secondary aspiration pneumonia is a major risk. Thoracic radiography confirms the presence of a diffuse megaesophagus that differentiates this cause of regurgitation from the megaesophagus associated with vascular ring malformations, which obstruct the esophagus at the base of the heart. These vascular ring malformations also cause regurgitation in the puppy at the time it is weaned. For many years, this congenital idiopathic diffuse megaesophagus was thought to be a neuromuscular disorder on the basis of the ability to reproduce it by experimental vagotomies or the bilateral electrolytic destruction of the nucleus ambiguous. However, no microscopic or physiologic studies could confirm this in affected dogs. Although the esophageal hypomotility is associated with the failure of the gastroesophageal junction to open, no evidence of any increased muscle tone at this junction is apparent. However, there now has been physiologic evidence of dysfunction in the general visceral afferent, GVA, system involved in reflex esophageal function. The cause of the dysfunction has not been defined. Figure 6-47 shows a schematic diagram of the GSE and GVA innervation of the esophagus. No definitive treatment is available for this megaesophagus, but the movement of food from the esophagus into the stomach may be improved by feeding a soft, semi-solid diet to the animal that has been trained to eat while standing on its pelvic limbs, with its forepaws elevated on a stool or table, and to maintain that position for 15 to 20 minutes after consuming a food. This is one situation when feeding the dog at the table is appropriate, as long as the correct quality of food is offered. This esophageal disorder is uncommon in cats, perhaps because of the differences in the muscle type of the esophagus. Guttural pouch mycosis in adult horses. Dysphagia is one of the two most common clinical signs of a fungal infection of the guttural pouch. The other clinical sign is epistaxis. The guttural pouch is a sac-like ventral diverticulum of the auditory tube that is situated dorsal to the pharynx on each side and ventral to the cranium and atlas. Figure 6-48 through 6-50. A species of Aspergillus that normally may inhabit the guttural pouch is the most common cause of this infection. The infection causes inflammation of the mucosa of the guttural pouch that extends deep to the mucosa to invade the structures it covers, which include a number of cranial nerve branches and blood vessels. Figure 6-51. The most common site for this inflammation is the dorsicaudal aspect of the medial compartment. The pharyngeal branches of cranial nerves 9 and 10 course ventrally adjacent to this medial compartment to reach the pharyngeal muscles that are ventral to the guttural pouch. When the inflammation involves these nerve branches, a partial dysphagia results, and food is observed at the nares. arteries of these horses. The epistaxis is most commonly associated with the inflammation eroding into the internal carotid artery or occasionally into the maxillary artery. Bleeding occurs into the guttural pouch, and from there, the blood drains through the pharyngeal orifice into the nasopharynx, then into the nasal cavities, and out the nares. Other neurologic signs associated with guttural pouch mycosis include laryngeal hemiparesis caused by involvement of the vagus nerve, Horner syndrome, resulting from lesions in the cranial cervical ganglion or its postganglionic axons in the internal carotid nerve that is associated with the internal carotid artery, less commonly, facial nerve paresis and hypoglossal nerve paresis, and, rarely, clinical signs of vestibular nerve dysfunction resulting from the inflammation eroding into the tympanic cavity and causing otitis media interna. Treatment of this mycosis is difficult. Surgical procedures to prevent epistaxis by occluding the blood flow in the internal carotid artery or the maxillary artery are commonly followed by resolution of the inflammatory lesion. Equine laryngeal hemiparesis, hemiplegia, the most common laryngeal disorder that is recognized clinically, occurs in racehorses. This is primarily a left hemiparesis that causes an inspiratory dyspnea, which interferes with the athletic performance of the patient. Most of the horses at risk for this disorder are 15 hands tall or taller and have long necks. It is not seen in ponies. Many of the pathogenetic mechanisms that have been proposed for this disorder relate to the asymmetric origin of the recurrent laryngeal nerves from the vagus nerves in the cranial mediastinum. The left recurrent laryngeal nerve has a longer course, having to pass around the ligamentum arteriosum and aortic arch before continuing cranially along the trachea to the larynx. The right recurrent laryngeal nerve only has to pass around the right subclavian artery to reach the trachea. In the first two editions of this text, I supported the hypothesis that the longer left recurrent laryngeal nerve was at risk for injury where it coursed around the aorta and could be stretched there by movements of the long neck. We now know that this hypothesis is incorrect, but the length of these recurrent laryngeal nerves is important. Denervation atrophy occurs in only the laryngeal muscles innervated by the recurrent laryngeal nerves, which is much more extensive on the left side. Figure 6-52 and 6-53. Microscopic study of the recurrent laryngeal nerves shows an axonal degeneration and demyelination that is most pronounced at the larynx and decreases in the retrograde direction along the more proximal components of these nerves. The current hypothesis is that this disorder is a dying back neuropathy caused by the inability of the cell bodies in the motor nucleus of the accessory nerve in the middle to maintain the integrity of such long motor neurons. In affected horses, lesions may be found in both recurrent laryngeal nerves, but they are much more extensive in the left nerve, which further supports the hypothesis of dying back neuropathy. Similar lesions may be found in the distal branches of the sciatic nerve where they innervate the crural muscles. These are also very long neurons, but no clinical signs of the loss of these neurons have been recognized. This hypothesis is supported by the absence of any lesions in the cranial laryngeal nerve, which is a short branch of the vagus nerve that innervates the cricothyroid muscle. Although the recurrent laryngeal nerve innervates all the intrinsic muscles of the larynx except the cricothyroid, the muscle most essential to open the glottis and increase the size of the airway is the cricoridinoideus dorsalis muscle. As these lesions progress, varying degrees of paresis occur in the function of dilating the glottis. When the vocal folds cannot be fully abducted, they interfere with the flow of air on inspiration, causing the characteristic inspiratory dyspnea, figure 6-54. This is exacerbated by the air entering the laryngeal ventricle and further displacing the vocal fold into the airway. When the paresis is severe, a noise is audible, which has led to the term equine roaring syndrome. Equine practitioners define four grades of laryngeal hemiparesis based on the endoscopic examination of the larynx at rest and during treadmill exercise. Video 6-8. Treatments and prognosis depend on determination of the grade of hemiparesis. Surgery is recommended for the more severely affected horses with the goal of maintaining the left vocal fold in a permanently abducted position. A suture is placed in the position of the cricoridinoideus dorsalis muscle between the muscular process of the arytenoid cartilage and the caudal aspect of the cricoid cartilage. Tension on this suture mechanically abducts the vocal fold. An inherited basis of this laryngeal disorder is suspected but, except for the risk involved in selection for taller long-necked horses, has not been defined. Toxicity laryngeal paralysis has been reported in Arabian foals in association with the administration of the organophosphate anthelmintic haloxone starting at 2 days of age. Chronic lead poisoning in horses causes a polyneuropathy that includes the recurrent laryngeal nerves and results in laryngeal paresis. Cranial mediastinal lesions. The recurrent laryngeal nerves are at risk for being involved with lesions that develop in the cranial mediastinum. In horses, they include lymph node abscesses caused by Streptococcus equi. In cats and dogs, lymphoma and thymoma are concerned at this location. Canine laryngeal paralysis. Canine laryngeal paralysis occurs as an inherited disorder or an acquired disease. Inherited laryngeal paralysis in dogs is most commonly an inherited degenerative disorder of the neurons in the recurrent laryngeal nerves. The neuropathy may affect only the recurrent laryngeal nerves, or their dysfunction may be part of a more diffuse polyneuropathy or may be a combination of neuropathy and encephalomyelopathy. It is critical to discuss with owners the possibility of a generalized neuromuscular disorder or encephalomyelopathy prior to any surgical correction of the larynx. In our opinion, the most thorough study of inherited laryngeal paralysis was performed at the University of Utrecht in young Bouvier des Flandres dogs. These young dogs were presented at 4 to 6 months of age for not growing well, exhibiting fatigue to the point of collapse and even cyanosis when exercised, and noisy breathing caused by the marked inspiratory dyspnea. These severe clinical signs of laryngeal paralysis required that laryngeal surgery be performed if the patients were to survive. Studies determined that this progressive laryngeal paresis was caused by bilateral abiotrophy of neurons in the motor nucleus of the accessory nerve that innervated the larynx, and this abit. Raffi was inherited as an autosomal dominant genetic disorder. Responsible dedicated breeders in the Netherlands were able to eliminate this disorder from the breed in a few years of careful control of their selection of dogs for breeding. North American dog breeders could take some lessons from these responsible individuals. A similar progressive laryngeal paresis to paralysis is inherited in young Siberian and Husky crossbred racing dogs, Bull Terriers, and Dalmatians. Dalmatians may also have other signs of polyneuropathy. The patterns of inheritance and the pathologies of these disorders are less well defined than are those of the Bouviers. In Chapter 5, we describe laryngeal paralysis in 1 to 3 year old Leon Bergers, which is followed in a few weeks by the clinical signs of progressive sciatic tibial nerve deficit. In time, tetraparesis occurs. It is inherited as an autosomal recessive genetic disorder. Take, for example, an 8 to 10 week old Rottweiler pup that is presented with the clinical signs of progressive laryngeal paresis. Inspiratory dyspnea may be the only clinical sign that is recognized, and surgery is performed to establish a more adequate airway. At 12 to 14 weeks of age, the owner comes back with this dog because of a progressive gait abnormality that can be recognized as a dysfunction of the and general proprioceptive tracts in the spinal cord. This is an inherited autosomal genetic disorder that affects the central nervous system, CNS, especially the spinal cord tracts and the peripheral nervous system, especially the recurrent laryngeal nerves. The initial clinical signs may involve the pelvic limb gate, the larynx, or both. If the clinical signs of laryngeal paresis occur first, surgery may be performed on a dog that will, in a few weeks to months, exhibit the signs of a progressive gait disorder that will ultimately cause recumbency and warrant euthanasia. This inherited disease of Rottweiler dogs was published in 1997 as an urinal vacuolation and spinocerebellar degeneration, but in reality, this is a diffuse encephalomyelopathy and polyneuropathy. This disorder is described in case example 10-16 and chapter 10. In the discussion on small animal cervical spinal cord diseases, progressive laryngeal paresis has also been reported in Rottweiler dogs as part of a diffuse polyneuropathy that causes elementary paresis. We are not aware of a progressive laryngeal paresis in the Rottweiler breed that is not associated with other neurologic signs and lesions, so great care should be taken before performing laryngeal surgical intervention. Acquired, idiopathic, and acquired idiopathic laryngeal paralysis occurs in older large breed dogs with or without other significant signs of neuromuscular disease, for example, involvement of other long nerves such as the sciatic nerve. It is common in Labrador Retrievers, St. Bernards, Newfoundlands, Rottweilers, and Chesapeake Bay Retrievers. Recent electrophysiologic and nerve biopsy studies of these dogs that present with significant signs of laryngeal paralysis strongly support this to be an early sign of a more generalized neuropathy that may have the pattern of a dying back axonopathy that predominantly affects long neurons such as those in the recurrent laryngeal and sciatic nerves. As a rule, surgical treatment of the laryngeal paralysis is justified, as the laryngeal paralysis may be life-threatening, and the clinical deficits caused by this neuropathy in other long nerves are mild and do not usually prevent ambulation. That being said, the owners must be informed that the sciatic nerve dysfunction will eventually cause a gait abnormality that may interfere with the working dog's ability to perform normally. This has been the case in some Labrador Retrievers used for hunting. The cause of this neuropathy remains unknown in these older dogs, and the pathogenesis may not be the same in all affected dogs. Many of these dogs suffer from chronic hypothyroidism, and some may improve with treatment. Must require laryngeal surgery to improve their inspiration and ability to exercise. The relationship between the chronic hypothyroidism and the laryngeal paralysis is not well understood. Both myopathy and neuropathy occur with this endocrine disorder in humans. Other cranial nerve and even brainstem signs have been associated with hypothyroidism solely on the basis of some response to therapy. No adequate pathologic studies have been performed in these dogs. See previous discussion with idiopathic facial neuropathy neuritis. Occasionally, the dogs with this laryngeal paralysis also have megaesophagus. Until we understand this disorder better, these dogs should be evaluated for their thyroid status and the possibility of focal myasthenia gravis by evaluating their serum for antibodies against acetylcholine receptors. Feline laryngeal paralysis. Laryngeal paralysis is uncommon in cats. Unilateral paresis may follow injury to the carotid sheath during venipuncture, dog bites, or thyroid surgery. An infiltrative lymphoma may cause unilateral or bilateral laryngeal paresis. It is likely that a unilateral paralysis will not be recognized clinically because of the relative inactivity of this species. Injury. It is important to be aware that laryngeal hemiparesis or hemiplegia may follow an injury to the recurrent laryngeal nerve, where it is still a component of the vagus nerve in the carotid sheath in the neck. At this site, it is at risk for injury by aggressive attempts at external jugular venipuncture in any species, dog bites in small animals, ventral surgical approaches to the cervical intervertebral discs in dogs, and thyroid surgery. I have caused laryngeal paralysis in a middle-aged Springer Spaniel while taking the surgical approach to a ventral slot procedure in the cervical vertebrae. The carotid sheath is only a few millimeters deep to the external jugular vein, and they are separated only by soft tissue. Serious injury to the contents of this sheath causes laryngeal hemiparesis or hemiplegia from injury to the recurrent laryngeal nerve and Horner syndrome from injury to the preganglionic sympathetic axons in the cervical sympathetic trunk coursing to the head. I have seen a small pony with a heavily muscled neck collapse as a result of bilateral laryngeal paralysis following unsuccessful attempts to access the external jugular vein on both sides of the neck. Injury to the GVE and GVA neurons of one vagus nerve will not be recognized clinically. Cranial nerve 12, hypoglossal neurons anatomy. The GSE neuronal cell bodies are located in the motor nucleus of the hypoglossal nerve in the medulla. See plates 14 and 15 in chapter 2. This nucleus is adjacent to the median plane and to the floor of the fourth ventricle. It is a long nucleus, 3 to 5 mm, extending from the obric caudale nearly to the level of the acoustic striostrially. See figure 6-1 and 6-3. The axons pass directly ventrally and slightly laterally through the reticular formation and across the lateral portion of the olivary nucleus. They emerge lateral to the pyramid as a longitudinal series of small roots. This row of hypoglossal roots merges at the small hypoglossal canal to form the hypoglossal nerve. The neurons course to innervate the extrinsic tongue muscles, styloglossus, hyoglossus, and genioglossus, the intrinsic tongue muscles, and the genia hyoideus. The hypoglossal nerve is much smaller inside the cranial cavity than outside the skull. This is the result of the increase in myelination and connective tissue that occurs after the nerve emerges from the hypoglossal canal. Clinical signs: lesions in any parts of these hypoglossal neurons result in impairment of the function of the tongue in prehension, deglutition, mastication, and speech. The most reliable clinical sign of a unilateral lesion is atrophy of the tongue. The clinician must be sure to look at the tongue carefully during the cranial nerve examination because it is easy to miss mild unilateral atrophy. If the patient protrudes its tongue, it may deviate toward the denervated side because of contraction of the normal contralateral genioglossus and intrinsic tongue muscles. The animal may be observed to lick its lips only on the paralyzed side. An early sign of a unilateral hypoglossal nerve lesion may be the presence of fasciculations of the denervated half of the tongue. Diseases in the dog: unilateral tongue atrophy is most commonly caused by an extraparenchymal lesion involving the hypoglossal nerve roots, figure 6-55. In the horse, unilateral tongue atrophy is almost pathognomonic for an S. neurona infection of the hypoglossal nucleus in the medulla. See case example 6-2. This may occur with or without other signs of medullary disease. In some horses, the lesion is limited to this nucleus, and had autopsy, the cell bodies are seen to have been replaced by astrocytes. In cattle, the most common cause of tongue paresis is encephalitis in the medulla caused by monocytogenes, figure 6-56. The clinician must be sure to pull the tongue out of the mouth in horses and cattle to assess tongue strength and to look for atrophy. This is much more difficult to do in normal cattle than in horses. Care must be taken not to be too aggressive because it is possible to injure the hypoglossal innervation and have the tongue fail to be retracted into the mouth. A hyoid bone fracture or careless stylohyoid bone surgery in horses may also injure the hypoglossal nerve on one side. Clinical signs of vestibular nerve dysfunction associated with otitis media interna are common in domestic animals. However, to avoid overlooking a central cause of vestibular system signs, it is important to look carefully for involvement of other closely associated cranial nerves such as the hypoglossal nerve. Diffuse lower motor neuron diseases. Many of the diseases described in chapter 5 that diffusely affect spinal nerve GSE, LMN also affect cranial nerve nerve GSE, LMN or the muscle innervated. Botulism is a good example of this because it commonly causes dysphagia, facial paresis, and jaw and tongue paresis. An acute onset of diffuse spinal nerve LMN signs that are accompanied by these cranial nerve LMN signs makes botulism a strong consideration for the clinical diagnosis. Myasthenia gravis may cause facial and laryngeal paresis and commonly causes regurgitation from esophageal muscle paresis. North American tick paralysis and polyradiculoneuritis in dogs usually cause only mild facial paresis. Polyneuritis equi may cause facial paresis. Diffuse autoimmune polymyositis may include masticatory and pharyngeal muscles and cause dysphagia of the esophagus and cause regurgitation. Encephalitis involving the brainstem may produce clinical signs that include dysfunction of one or more of the cranial nerves that contain GSE, LMN. This is common in listeriosis in ruminants and when S. neurona affects the brainstem in horses. The type C retrovirus that causes caprine arthritis encephalitis, key, in goats and rabies in all species are other examples. Prosencephalon, the clinician must be aware that acute prosencephalitis orders may cause mild cranial nerve signs as a result of a sudden interference with the M-corticonic limb pathways that are involved in voluntary efforts that require cranial nerve GSE, LMN activity. This is observed more commonly in horses and farm animals and is usually exhibited as dysphagia. Less commonly, facial paresis may be observed. For example, in horses, dysphagia may follow the sudden destruction of cerebral white matter, leukoencephalomalacia caused by moldy corn poisoning. This results from the ingestion of Fumonisin B1, the mycotoxin produced by the fungus Fusarium melliformis that grows on forages. In cattle, dysphagia may occur with severe acute prosencephalic hemorrhagic necrosis caused by Histophilus somnus vasculitis. Signalment: 2-year-old Holstein cow chief complaint, walking in circles and difficulty eating history. For 6 days before presentation, this cow had been walking in circles, usually to her right side. For 3 days, she was noticed to have difficulty in swallowing, and she developed a left ear droop. Examination: Video 6-9 shows the bilateral ear droop and lack of closure of the eyelids to a menacer or a direct stimulus with forceps. She was visual and would move away from menacing gestures. Facial sensation was normal as is seen when the nasal septal mucosa was stimulated. Note the constant tongue protrusion and the lack of response when the tongue was handled. Note the lack of tonal manipulation of the mandible and the inability to close the mouth. Abduction and adduction of the eyes were poor when the head was moved in a horizontal plane to test normal physiologic nystagmus. Pupil size and light response were normal. Note her tendency to circle to the right when free in the pen, and watch her scuff the digits of her left limbs. Anatomic diagnosis: the brainstem nuclei are nerves of cranial nerves 3, 5, 6, 7, 9, 10, and 12 bilaterally, caudal brainstem and general proprioceptive pathways on the left side. It was impossible to tell how much of the dysphagia was caused by the dysfunction of cranial nerves 5 and 12 or the pharyngeal neurons of cranial nerves 9 or 10, or both. Involvement of the ascending reticular activating system in the morostral brainstem could account for her mild depression. Circling may occur with asymmetric vestibular disorders and may be related to the loss of balance, or it may be propulsive and be related to an asymmetric frontoparietal basal nuclear lesion. The latter correlation is not well defined, and propulsive circling may occur with diencephalic or even mesencephalic lesions when the latter involves the substantia nigra. Most of the time, propulsive circling is directed to the side of the lesion, but not always. The extensive bilateral cranial nerve dysfunction with minimal gait disorder suggests that this lesion may be extraparenchymal, perhaps an abscess that has spread along the floor of the cranial cavity. However, the left side gait deficit requires involvement of neurons in the pons and medulla, and the circling does not appear to be related to a balance problem. Therefore, the indication is that the lesion involves central motor systems, not the vestibular portion of cranial nerve 8. Differential diagnosis: listeriosis, abscess, rabies, thrombotic meningoencephalitis, malignant catarrhal fever, listeriosis. Listeriosis is the most common inflammation in the brain of dairy cattle and is characterized by the involvement of cranial nerve neurons in the medulla and pons. The infectious agent is the bacterium malmonocytogenes, which is thought to gain access to the brain by invading the sensory nerve endings in the oral mucosa and migrating over these nerves to the pons, where the trigeminal nerve enters the brainstem. This accounts for the predominance of lesions at this site. Prosencephalic lesions are very uncommon, which is why central blindness is not seen in this encephalitis. Various combinations of facial paralysis and vestibular ataxia with a head tilt are the most common cranial nerve signs observed in listeriosis. These clinical signs are also seen in otitis media interna. However, in cattle with listeriosis, the recognition of other cranial nerve signs or gait abnormalities caused by general proprioceptive pathway dysfunction make otitis an untenable clinical diagnosis. The extent of cranial nerve involvement in this cow is unusual for listeriosis, which is why an extraparenchymal suppurative leptomeningeal infection was given strong consideration. See the earlier discussion about the anatomic diagnosis. Abscess: a suppurative leptomeningitis resulting from a pituitary abscess or an extension from an otitis media interna could spread on the floor of the cranial cavity and readily explain the severe bilateral involvement of the cranial nerves in this cow. If the lesion was more severe on the left side and compressed the caudal brainstem, this lesion could account for the mild left side gait deficit. A lesion at this site would be less likely to cause the circling that was observed. Rabies: in the opinion of Dr. Francis Fox at Cornell University, a large animal veterinarian with more than 50 years of experience, the most typical clinical signs related to a rabies virus infection are their atypical appearance. This is a neurotrophic virus that includes infection of GSE neurons. The only reason for listing this diagnosis of rabies after the other two is that usually after 6 days of neurologic signs caused by the rabies virus, this cow would be unable to stand. Thrombotic meningoencephalitis caused by the bacterium Histophilus somnus, an acute brain disorder in cattle that would not be expected to affect the cranial nerves in such an extensive and bilateral manner. This disease is more common in the feedlots of the Midwest than in a New York State dairy farm, which was the location of this cow. Malignant catarrhal fever causing neurologic signs is uncommon in upstate New York. It is caused by a herpes virus that infects cattle that reside on the same premises as sheep. It is usually an acute fulminating systemic disease that affects only the nervous system in the chronic stages, and cranial nerve signs are uncommon. Polyencephalomalacia caused by thiamine deficiency, sulfur intoxication, or lead poisoning is not included in this discussion because it is primarily a disorder of the prosencephalon and therefore would not be correlated with the anatomic diagnosis of this cow. Lumbosacral CSF in the cow in this case example contained 17 white blood cells per cubic millimeter, mm3, normal, 5, with 71% macrophages, 19% lymphocytes, and 10% neutrophils, and with 66 milligrams per deciliter, mgdl, of protein, normal, 40. This is most compatible with listeriosis or possibly rabies and is less likely to be suppurative leptomeningitis. Listeriosis is treated with large doses of penicillin and has a fair prognosis if the cow is still standing, but the severity of the cranial nerve involvement in this cow suggested a guarded prognosis. This cow was treated but went down on the second day of treatment and was euthanized. At autopsy, an extensive inflammation was present in the brainstem, and the Elmanocytogene's organism was identified in the lesion by using an immunocytochemical procedure. It must be kept in mind that this organism may be zoonotic and cause infection in the brain of humans, so veterinary personnel should protect themselves when examining a patient like this. Video 6-10 shows a 6-month-old Holstein heifer with a 4-day history of depression, excessive lying down, protruding tongue, excessive salivation, and difficulty eating. Note the heifer's ability to walk, but with a slight vestibular ataxia, cranial nerve 8 deficit. Note the frequent bumping of her head into the wall and the lack of any response to a menace. Not seen are the dilated pupils that would not respond to light. Deficit of cranial nerve 2, 3, or both. Note the dropped mandible, lack of tone in the muscles of mastication, and inability to move the mandible. Bilateral motor cranial nerve 5 deficit. The protruded hypotonic tongue, bilateral cranial nerve 12 deficit. The mild facial hypalgia that is worse on the right side, sensory cranial nerve 5 deficit. The moderately weak eyelids, cranial nerve 7 deficit, and a lack of normal physiologic nystagmus. Deficit of bilateral cranial nerve 3 and 6. Anatomic diagnosis. Bilateral cranial nerves 2, 3, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and 12. This anatomic diagnosis is similar to that made in case example 6-1 that involved a 2-year-old cow, and it should engender the same discussion concerning the differential diagnosis. However, this 6-month-old heifer had no clinical signs that could occur only in the brainstem. For example, propulsive circling or a gait disorder involving the upper motor neuron and general proprioceptive systems. Therefore, an extraparenchymal lesion would be more likely than a brainstem lesion. This observation and the knowledge that cattle with listeriosis are usually 1 year old or older and are not blind supports the presumptive clinical diagnosis of a suppurative leptomeningitis spread on the floor of the cranial cavity from the optic canals to the hypoglossal canals. Because of the poor prognosis, this heifer was euthanized, and had autopsy a large, firm mass of highly organized suppurative meningitis was found that extended from the optic nerves to the caudal medulla, figure 6-57 through 6-59. This mass could be peeled off the ventral surface of the brainstem with tearing of the cranial nerves that were entrapped in it. It was suspected that this large mass of suppuration may have come from a pituitary abscess that had ruptured. Case example 6-2 Signalment, 5-year-old thoroughbred gelding, case chief complaint, head and pelvic muscle atrophy, inability to rise history. The clinical signs observed in this horse were progressive over about a 3-month period. The initial clinical sign observed was atrophy of the left muscles of mastication, figure 6-60. This occurred while the gelding was still racing. A few weeks later, atrophy was observed in the right gluteal muscles, figure 6-61, and the gait was altered in the right pelvic limb. Case was taken out of racing and store rested. In the week before the video was made, his pelvic limb gait problems progressed rapidly, and he went down. When assisted, he could stand only on his thoracic limbs, like a sitting dog. Examination. Video 6-11 shows the atrophy of the left masseter and temporal muscles in the right side of the tongue, figure 6-62. When assisted to stand with the help of Professors Robert Whitlock, University of Pennsylvania, and Ian Mayhew, Massey University, when they were on the faculty at Cornell University, the horse could still move his pelvic limbs. The short rapid pelvic limb movements to advance the limbs but the inability to support weight suggests involvement of the L4 to L6 spinal cord segments, spinal nerves, or both femoral nerves. A mild loss of tone in the tail and anus and a mild atrophy of the right caudal thigh muscles were observed. Hypalgia in this area was difficult to assess. Thoracic limbs were normal. Anatomic diagnosis. Left motor 5 nucleus or the mandibular nerve branch from cranial nerve 5, right hypoglossal nucleus or the hypoglossal nerve, L4, L5, L6, sacral and caudal spinal cord segments, spinal nerve roots, spinal nerves, both femoral nerves in the right sciatic and cranial gluteal nerves. Differential diagnosis. Equine protozoal encephalomyelitis, polyneuritis equi, equine herpes virus 1 vasculitis, and encephalomy. Elopathy. Equine protozoal encephalomyelitis, a chronic form of infection by S. neurona, is the most presumptive diagnosis for this horse based on the multifocal asymmetric clinical signs of predominantly gray matter lesions, especially the very focal brainstem nuclear lesions without other clinical signs of brainstem disease. We have never seen such a localized nuclear lesion in any other equine disease. See case example 11-2 in chapter 11 for a complete description of this disease. Polyneuritis equi. Most horses with polyneuritis equi have a more severe and bilateral lesion in the sacrocaudal spinal nerve. nerves but not enough lumbar spinal nerve involvement to cause inability to stand and walk. If cranial nerves are affected, it is less severe than in this case, and we are not aware of any involvement of the hypoglossal nerves in polyneuritis equi. This disease is described in case example 5-9 in chapter 5. Equine herpes virus 1. Equine herpes virus 1 causes vasculitis of small blood vessels in the CNS, which results in thrombosis and amyelopathy with ischemic or hemorrhagic infarction of the CNS parenchyma. The clinical signs are always acute and onset and non-progressive after about 72 hours. In mild cases, the lesions are mostly in the thoracolumbar spinal cord white matter, causing an upper motor neuron paresis and general proprioceptive ataxia limited to the pelvic limbs. In addition, there is usually a mild loss of tone in the tailing anus and difficulty in emptying the bladder. We have not seen cranial nerve signs in this disorder. See case example 11-3 for a complete description of this disease. In this case example, the lumbosacral CSF was xanthochromic and contained 31 white blood cells per mm3, normal, 5, and 106 mgdl of protein, normal, 80. At the time that this horse was studied, there were no antibody assays for the protozoal agent, which had yet to be identified. This horse was euthanized in autopsy. There were grossly visible discolorations at the sites of the anatomic diagnosis. Figure 6-63 through 6-73 show these lesions and provide descriptions of their relationships to the clinical signs. Protozoal organisms were present in the lumbosacral lesion. It is assumed that the S. neurona protozoal agent gains access to the CNS from blood, but the focal GSC motor neuronal lesions observed in this horse suggest that a possible route of entry may be from muscles, with the organism passing retrograde through the motor innervation to the GSC cell bodies in the brainstem nuclei or spinal cord ventral gray column. No organisms have been described in the muscles of any of these horses, but these studies have been few. However, an extremely huge volume of horse muscle would be needed for such studies.